I said to the guy, I said, this stuff I've been doing tonight, do you think you could think of things like this? And he says, oh, my goodness, God, no way in the world. I go, yeah, that's what I was thinking.
You're listening to What a Joke.
With Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster.
On Netflix is a joke radio.
Welcome back, everybody, to What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Feimster.
And we are very excited.
Yeah, it's a big day.
We have a big announcement.
Yeah, we do.
The guest that we have coming in today is none other than the great Jerry Seinfeld.
I mean, holy cow. I'm so excited.
Yeah. No, this is going to be great. Look, the whole reason we're doing this show is because we love comedy. And we want to discuss comedy. We want to play comedy. We want to hang with comedians. This is a good one.
It gets no bigger, in my opinion, when it comes to comedy than Jerry Seinfeld.
Well, well.
This is in progress.
This is it.
We're
on the air.
Happening. Jerry's
we want you coming in like a Dean Martin roast.
Nice Fortune. To meet you, Jerry. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Mwah.
Good to see you, buddy. I'll hug you now.
Good to see you. Good to see you. How easy is this going to be?
Oh,
this is going to be,
It's going to be the best interview of your life.
What's the one thing every comedian wants to know when he walks into any room where they need him to do anything?
Are there other funny people?
No. Well, this is first question.
Oh, man.
First question, always, everywhere, anything.
How much time?
Yes.
You're like, when's the light coming on?
When is this over?
Headphones.
So we could hear ourselves.
I guess we don't.
Don't know. I mean, we're doing radio.
I've been watching Howard Stern.
We're not far.
I don't watch.
Yeah.
And everybody's got the headphones. They go, how come you can go on Jimmy Fallon without headphones, but Howard Stern with radio from 1928, we need headphones?
Yeah.
Explain. I mean, maybe you have some producer telling you stuff.
Yeah.
No break.
Hey, we can go to
now
break
that
now.
You've mentioned that,
but I'm not wearing them.
I can hear you better without headphones.
Yeah, it's kind of weird, right?
Yeah.
I said to Fortune, I said, I'll tell you exactly what's going to happen. Jerry's going to come in. He's going to tell you everything you're doing wrong.
Can you fix our show?
Step one.
And he's going to be right.
Ditch the
headphones. He's going to be right.
It helps for my hair. I already look more beautiful.
Every comic you ever see, whenever they have video of some comic doing some radio show,
Everybody,
we in space? It's radio.
And it's not like you're far from us. I can literally reach out and touch you.
Break a sweat.
All right, let's do it. Yeah. Well, this whole thing, I was telling Fortune that you're responsible for most of my decisions in show business. You're responsible for me taking this gig because we were at the diner hanging out and I brought it up and thought, I wasn't sure what your take was going to be. And you're like, comedians, comedy, clips, do it.
Okay, so What a Joke is the name of the show?
What a Joke with Papa and Fortune.
That's a good
Papa
name.
And Fortune.
You like the name?
I like the name, yeah. What
a
joke.
What a joke.
And then when we like a clip, what a joke.
And then, was that a joke?
We're on the radio. What a joke.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how are you doing with the writing? What's going on?
I'm very good with it.
The best.
I'm really good with it because I have, you and I had a conversation in Toledo, Ohio.
Right.
In 2017?
17, yeah.
I'm going to guess.
Yeah.
And listen to this, Fortune. So Tom and I walking along, we do our comedy walk, you know, we get up, we have our breakfast, we go to the movie, we have the lunch, and we take our walk.
Yeah.
We take the walk, you know, and that's when we shake it down.
Yeah.
And so we start talking about writing, and comedy is about, obviously, it's material.
Right.
Because the material is the gold, and the material is what makes you want to go on stage again.
Yeah.
You go, oh, I wonder if that's going to work.
Mm-hmm.
Now you want to go do a set.
Yeah.
You know, so again, back to inertia.
Yeah.
So we're taking our walk, and I go, what if we didn't do anything for a year? What if we took a year and just said, I'm not doing anything but working on material for a year? That's a fantasy.
Right.
You know. And then.
Sounds great.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not going to do anything else. Yeah. Anybody calls? No. I'm busy.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, in the morning, you're going to have a morning little writing session that you're going to do every day.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not going to make any appointments. And anybody calls, too bad. I'm available after noon.
Yeah.
Not till 12.
That's right.
You know. And that's where it started, right?
Yeah,
that conversation.
That was it. And we both decided no appointments until noon.
No appointments till noon.
But we knew we couldn't say no to the rest of our life. There's family, there's
your kids need you.
Shows, things are going to happen. You're making the TV show, whatever.
Yeah.
But to block off that time,
mm-hmm.
7 to noon, and to your best of your ability, no appointments, no phone calls, nothing.
For a whole year.
And just
for a year.
For a year.
And then we started thinking, well, why would you have to, why can't we do that?
Always, yeah.
Yeah, and they started, I started thinking, hey, I'm somebody.
I can make these
Wasn't
plans.
Wasn't that a funny thing you had with the
you
heckle?
You ain't nobody.
You ain't nobody.
You ain't nobody.
I never heard that heckle. He was talking about things, mean things people yell out.
Yeah.
You ain't nobody. That's such a funny heckle. Anyway, so after that conversation, I sat down with my wife
mm-hmm.
and my assistant. Assistants, plural.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Oh, you're fancy.
And I said, here's the way it's going to be from now on.
Uh-huh.
Don't even.
Yeah.
There's nothing.
Yeah.
I said to my wife, I'm going to start acting differently.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to be. It's so dumb. Because it's the simplicity of it, right?
Right.
Yes, but it takes a long time to kind of see that is the thing.
Like, well, especially when other people are in your house, you do have to sit them down and have that conversation. Otherwise, they're like, let's go get breakfast.
No.
Really?
No. First of all, they're not interested in what you're doing. They don't care.
That's so funny to see you having a sit down with them and being like, what was that all about?
Yeah.
Right. Do what you want to do.
They're
we don't care.
Fine. We don't want to see you in the morning anyway.
Yeah. We don't know what you do now.
Why don't we get into this? This is the other weird thing, is the concept of writing is so alien. Actual mm-hmm. writing is so alien. To most comedians.
Yeah.
I have to write all of my material.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I can't. There are a lot of comics who get up and write it on stage as it comes. And I love improv, but I love to know where I'm going.
Right.
With my joke.
Here's Ricky Gervais, who's a comedy genius.
Yeah.
Okay? He's a comedy genius.
Mm-hmm.
He's a moron when it comes to writing stand-up. A moron.
He doesn't do
You know what he said to me? I did his podcast last week in London. He says, well, you can't do stand-up that way because you could be writing something on paper and you could be going off in a complete wrong direction and not know it. What are you talking about? You will know it very soon when you take it on stage.
Yeah, you'll know tonight.
Yeah,
from a guy who's written so many great things.
So much great stuff.
It's so
But
crazy.
That's his belief.
Yeah.
And how about Dave Chappelle the other night at the Fontaine Theater? He does his show.
Uh-huh.
The audience is filing out. Did you read this in the Times?
No.
You missed Jason Zinnemann? The audience is filing out. You're
going
to love this. Only Dave can do this.
Yeah.
Dave walks out onto the stage. They're leaving. The place is half empty.
Right.
He says, could you come back? I want to work on some new material.
Oh, my God.
So a quarter of the house traipses back.
Yeah.
This is on Broadway. They traipse back and they sit down, and then he stands there and just tries to riff.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Well, meanwhile.
What are you doing, dude?
There's all these ushers. Being like, oh, God.
Jeez, dinner.
He does like four-hour sets at the Comedy Store.
Yeah, yeah. That's what writing is.
But he's making
you stew it on with a piece of paper somewhere
in your house.
Yes, and just think,
write it out. But that I was telling Fortune I think the greatest blessing of becoming pals with you
mm-hmm.
when we first met was it was confirmation that you can work that way.
Mm-hmm.
That because I saw all these guys at the Cellar and no one seemed like they were writing. Nobody. And I was like, am I doing this wrong? Like, is this going to lead to anything? And then you came in and we're like, well, yeah, that's what you do. You take your pen, you put it on your pad,
mm-hmm.
and that's how you write. Of course, that's what you do.
There's something about it, whether it's a cubicle allegory or mm-hmm. it's a homework or schoolwork. metaphor. Sure. There's something about it that totally repels the comic mind.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I can't. I'm not doing that. That's work.
Yeah.
Right.
Which it is, but only in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Only in the first 10, 15 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Then
right.
you're kind of having fun.
Then yeah. you're enjoying it.
You're making up stuff. Who cares if mm-hmm. it works?
Yeah.
Who cares?
And you know it's towards getting better.
Yes.
That's mm-hmm. the biggest thing.
Yes.
But, you know, there's another part of it, of sitting down and writing, like when I had to write, like, longer stuff, like the book, that kind of thing. And it's isolating. Authors are very solitary mm-hmm. beings. Mm-hmm. And we, ultimately, are out there on the stage, social creatures. Mm-hmm. There, I could see there might be a thing that's at play there, too, because when we get to go out and do it at night.
Yeah.
But there's something, when I'm writing a lot, you get a little weird. You get kind of smaller.
A little dark.
Yeah, not even dark, but just you're solitary. Like,
yeah, see, that's who I am.
Some comics right. don't like to be alone.
Yeah, so the guy on stage, yeah. I made that up.
Right.
The real me is alone.
Mm-hmm.
That's
interesting.
Who I am.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I learned that the skill of people.
Of being out and social.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Being social, yeah. which I still can barely do.
Yeah.
But
I'd say that's
address
still...
people.
Yeah.
I invented that person.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
I invented that
person. You didn't have that as a kid running around, going in front of people.
No, I didn't mm-hmm. want to be in front of people ever.
Yeah.
Wow.
I remember one time when I was a kid, my parents took me to this magic show, and the guy wanted me to come up on stage.
Yeah.
And he went over to me and he took my hand. I was maybe 10.
Yeah.
And this guy got a yank back from me that frightened him. It's like, I am not getting up there.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was pretty shy, too. And
you were?
Yeah, you seem like a shy person.
I had to condition myself to be like, oh, I've got to, you know, I have to put myself out there.
Yeah.
I remember I was running for some class office and I was going to dance to a song I wasn't going to dance. There was music was supposed to play me up and it didn't come on.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just standing there and everyone's staring at me. And I remember not liking the silence of it. So
yeah.
I started dancing and doing body rolls and they started laughing. And I was like, oh, that. Putting myself out there had a response.
Right.
And it sort of conditioned something in me to make myself do the leap.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Laugh. Now it's easy for you.
Yeah, it comes more naturally right. now.
Yeah.
Yeah, now I'm made of steel.
But I'm very awkward when I have to talk to, like, people after the show.
Well,
like,
because they don't want, they're not interested in anything you're interested in.
Mm-hmm.
And everything you're interested in, it's not interesting to them.
Yeah.
It's really
yeah.
true.
Yeah.
It's really true.
Yeah.
Like after a show and I'll like actually speak honestly of like, so you thought that joke like in the middle, it seemed like I was starting to kind of go and they go blank. Like,
we're
just here to have fun. And
they're like,
chicken fingers.
We just wanted a selfie.
We just wanted to meet you.
What are you
yeah.
talking about?
I always feel like they leave so disappointed. They would have had such a better time if they just went right to the
so
car.
So awkward. I'm like bowing. I'm like, namaste. They're like, what is happening?
We talk about this sometimes when you aren't on the road as much, but you're still writing all mm-hmm. the time. You hit a point where it's like, I almost have to slow down the writing because I haven't been up on stage to try this out. Like, you're almost writing too much.
No.
No? You can just keep going?
Just keep going.
Oh, my
yeah.
God. I would love to have too much material.
Isn't it? You never
yeah.
will. Don't ever worry about it.
I was like, oh.
It'll never happen.
I need material. Oh, my God.
Yeah. And I'm, you know, so I'm 65. And I've done a lot in mm-hmm. comedy.
Yeah.
You know, I'm there.
Yeah.
You know,
that's it.
I'm there.
Yeah.
And I look out at the landscape now of people doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what I see. If you're going to get up on that stage and try and make people laugh, I don't want to hear from anybody about it.
Yeah.
Anybody. Whether we're talking your social media, critics, audience, anybody, everything they say is absolutely meaningless.
In the judgment of comedy.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
right.
Yeah.
I don't care what you did up there.
Right.
I don't care if, you know, because here's the two things you're going to get. Okay, let's. Do you do specials? Are you at that point yet?
I'm working towards that. Yeah. Okay. I mean, I've done
shooting in September.
I've done 2 half hours. I'm about to do my first hour.
Oh, great. Okay, yeah. So you've done a couple, and you're doing a third. Mm-hmm. There's two things you're gonna get. One is not as good as the last one, or I've heard a lot of that stuff before.
We just talked about that. Yeah.
Okay, so those are your two. You can pick one of the two.
Yeah.
Those are the only two reactions you will get.
Right.
Not as good as your last one.
Mm-hmm.
Or the stuff, I've heard her do a lot of that stuff before, which means it's good stuff.
Yeah.
That's what that means.
Right, exactly. Yeah. I think the audience was laughing again.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's kind of the fork in the road that they've given us as comedians. Take your pick.
Oh,
right.
Yeah. Yeah,
and to me, I don't care what you do. Do what you want.
Yeah.
Do what you want.
It's your time.
It's your time. You do what you want.
Right.
So, you know, we do the specials, you know.
Yeah.
And there are those jokes in the special. You still like, I want to do that joke. I like that joke.
Yeah.
Do the joke.
Right. If it makes you
happy.
All
the pressure of once it's come out.
Right.
Yeah, that's the worst when you're like,
it's not that,
I heard it and they're special. Yeah. They're acting like you're a loser now because you're doing your same joke.
Here's my story, which I've told you, Tom. You remember I was at Gotham one night, and I was working on a something, and I did a bunch of stuff, and this guy says to me, bright guy, New York City.
Right.
He says, so when you go back to a town that you've been to before, how do you know which material to change since you're going back there? And how do you know when it's time to stop doing certain material because you've done it a lot?
Mm-hmm. Right.
A very intelligent question.
Yeah.
I said, you remember my answer?
I don't.
I said to the guy, I said, this stuff I've been doing tonight, do you think you could think of things like this? And he says, oh, my goodness, God, no way in the world. I go, yeah, that's what I was thinking.
So get off my back.
So that's the end of that. That's the
get
end of our conversation.
My back.
Anything I do is great.
Right.
If I'm doing it, first of all, that means 10 crowds before you liked it.
Right.
So that means I came up with something.
That's right.
So
exactly.
Shut up and just enjoy it. It's a miracle. A joke is a miracle.
It is. It honestly,
okay. A joke
is
a miracle.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the other side of it, I said to Jerry, when it was all starting to happen, when everybody, like the last, I don't know, 5 years, everyone really started to talk comics. I don't, can I do that? I already did that before. Can
right.
I do it again? And I said to Jerry, is it okay to like do those jokes? Like, he goes, how big do you think you are that everybody has seen your act?
Yeah, that
really humbled me. I was like, you're exactly right.
Yeah.
And the people that do come back want to see it again.
Mm-hmm.
They're such fans that they love it. They don't care.
Whatever they want.
Yeah.
Would I like to do a new killer hour every night? Of course, we all would.
Right. Of course.
That's not Earth.
Yeah.
Right. That doesn't happen on Earth.
But I
do think there has been a change in the standard for the specials is lower.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We are fine. The audience is fine.
Mm-hmm.
If your new special is good but not great.
Right.
They're fine with that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not fine with it.
Mm-hmm.
For myself.
Right.
I'm not fine with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're fine with it.
Right.
That's the change.
Are they though?
Yes. They
you
are.
Think so?
Yeah,
for the long
yeah.
term, you think they are?
Yes, because we're in this crazy world we live in where we are fire hosed with content by the microsecond. We haven't got enough stuff.
Right.
So it makes no sense.
They
want to see you.
They just want more.
They just want more.
Yeah.
Right.
I disagree on a larger cultural macro lens, if you put the macro lens,
because
I'm from the 60s and 70s.
Right.
And people had acts. They did their acts. Their acts were killers.
Right.
And they grew very incrementally. There was no throwing. I mean, Pryor was the first guy and Cosby to just start throwing out huge chunks of material and just doing new stuff.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, and
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But
I feel
those are not average people.
Right.
Right. You know?
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the big thing. When people are like, I come up with an hour. You know, I did that hour last year. I'm going to do another one. I'm like,
yeah.
Who do you think you are?
Right.
Like, I mean, how many people really can do that?
I mean, well, it's called a stand-up special. Like, it should be special, mm-hmm. but I don't feel like that it's thought of in the same way anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But it, I don't know.
I'm doing a stand-up special in October that I would say it was my new set that I started writing probably in 2001.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, I've got probably 2.5 hours of stuff mm-hmm. that I've written that I think is good from then. But what I do in my act is the best of that.
Right.
And so now you want another one of those? I would need 20 more years to give you that quality
right.
Again.
Right. Mm-hmm.
20 more years.
Right.
But I really think an honest minimum is 5 years between hours.
Yeah.
That would be a really honest and working hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Working hard.
Right.
And I've seen guys, you know, people we love, people that we're fans of, and they come out 2-3 years later with the new one, and it's just, it's fluffy.
And you don't think there's a consequence to that?
Remains to be seen.
Right. Because I don't, you know, we all do what we do, and mm-hmm. I can't release something unless I know I honestly feel like it's ready. And I think to put it out early, I would know it, and if I know it, then they know it, and maybe they don't come back.
No, I don't think, number one, they don't know it.
Yeah.
They don't not come back, but more important and overarching all those things is it's not what you wanted to do.
Right.
You do a real artist.
Right.
A real artist does what they want to do.
Right.
And I'm not talking about being indulgent. I'm talking about that joke is good enough for
right.
me mm-hmm. to make my set. To
yeah.
be in my set.
To be in the lineup.
It's in the lineup. Yeah.
Right.
That's a winner.
Yeah.
And that's the standard to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right, exactly. He always talks about it in terms of a baseball team. Like, yeah. are you in the lineup or not?
Yeah.
He's
yeah.
like, well, that guy, he was really good for a while.
Yeah.
He doesn't even make the bench now.
Oh, man.
You got to hit your way into the lineup.
Oh,
yeah.
man. Got to get in that lineup.
Yeah. Yeah. As you're creeping towards shooting, you're going to shoot in September.
I'm shooting the end of September.
Yeah.
Really? Where?
In Charlotte, North Carolina.
Is that where you're from?
I'm from North Carolina,
oh,
yeah.
That's nice.
She grew up in the woods.
I did right. not. But I'm going on the road every week. I mean, I've been touring nonstop for the last 2 years with this.
Right. And how many years in are you?
Of stand-up?
Yeah.
I'm not great at math, Jerry.
It's really pretty
that's why we have years. We changed the number one digit every
year. 12 years in the stand-up.
Oh, 12 years? Oh, you're just a cute little
puppy. I know. I'm trying to get in on that lineup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, I'm excited.
That is a great time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
Because you know what you're doing.
Yeah, you're kind of really getting there now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you're gearing up for a special and you're going towards it, do you think you can overwork the set? Or do you feel like it's impossible to overwork
impossible.
It?
Impossible.
Because, yeah.
Take a couple of days off before you know, if you feel tired.
Right. Yeah. Just the physical part
of it. I'm going
out
every weekend.
Yeah.
I just want it to be good.
Yeah.
You just want it to be good. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
So.
Yeah, which it'll help it stand out.
Yeah. We'll find out. But I feel good about it, you know? And
right.
I can't control what other people will think about it, but I'm proud of it. And
right.
It will, I'm sure I'll watch it a year later and be like, ugh, you know, I have a tag to that thing now.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. The joke is better now.
But, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm doing what I want to do.
Right.
And,
right.
And we'll see what happens.
Right.
All right.
So
I tell Fortune you're like the comedy chiropractor. Like you have to make adjustments. You go see Jerry. You come out. You're like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Not only am I feel better, but I made the right choice in my life.
Right.
So we came up with a system of 7 to noon.
Well, we don't write 5 hours or whatever that is. Nobody's writing stand-up.
No,
for
but you're
hours.
In the shop. Mm-hmm. You're in the shop.
Yeah, yeah.
Some days you're doing a lot. Some days,
right.
But you're in the shop.
It's just that. That part of the day is vaulted. It's you know, secured,
right.
sealed off.
Right.
Yeah. And
so
you get to what you get to. I mean, then it gets. That's another interesting subject to me is how people go about that. But
right.
Anyway.
So as you may notice, I'm here at 7 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
and we go until 9. So I'm in a new show. So I'm in the midst of figuring out
mm-hmm.
the shift.
Yes.
Yeah.
I. came to the realization last night that my day just doubled in length because I have to go home at 12 is when, like, I can't just go right into it. So when I get home, a couple hours, do some TM, go into, hit the shop around noon, and now I've got to hang out in the shop, and it's, I don't know how it's going to work. Because the world is, you know, you've emailed, you've spoken on the phone.
Yeah.
You broke all the rules of the writing day.
Yeah, yeah.
So what do you think?
Well, oh, so you want me to help you with this?
Yes, sir.
Jerry's like,
you
oh,
told me to,
like, you have time,
why are we interested
time for
in
this?
You and Tom's you, day?
You told me, you told me, you told me take the gig.
Oh, so how do you, look.
Yeah.
I have an exercise guy who's a sports psych PhD,
uh-huh.
And I love this guy, and because we get to talk about sports psych, which is no different from comedy psych,
mm-hmm. Right?
You know,
right.
Golfers, tennis players. Oh, he works with all kinds of athletes who have their fachada. That's a Jewish word. They got issues, right? Which we all have.
Fachada.
So he helps them sort their stuff out. You
right,
know, their
right.
performance with uh-huh. what we do. So he and he's always podcasts and studies. This study came out and that study came out. And I love that kind of stuff. You
yeah.
know? But he says to me, what I have developed over the years, because I've explained to him what I do, he says, this is exactly what the studies show works.
Right.
So my answer to you is, he says, you know, and then he also works with like these hedge fund guys, you know, who are also interesting kind of sub and superhuman creatures,
yeah,
you know, they have a lot of the abilities that we don't want to have, and it makes them really boring, but it's also kind
for
of impressive
people,
what they
yeah.
could do.
Yeah,
so he says there's like two levels of guys. There's the guys that just have this talent and they can just make all kinds of money, but physically and life, their life's a mess, smoking,
right.
20 Diet Cokes, you know,
yeah.
just horrible physical sleeping,
yeah,
Ambien, you know. Everything,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
and they're
mass,
a wreck.
Arrest.
John Daly, our favorite
yeah,
guy, right?
We
but
love
the talent
John Daly.
Is the talent is so amazing, right?
Yeah.
Is, then you have the guys above those guys, who really kill it.
Yeah,
he says, and those guys, they have a system for everything,
right?
Every single minute of their day, mm-hmm. it
right,
gets plugged into a system,
yeah.
right?
You know, so what you have to do
is.
Invent a system. What's
build a
system?
New system.
Build a system.
Yeah, yeah, like Mark Wahlberg wakes up at like 4 a.m.
Really?
Get up earlier, Tom.
Earlier.
Oh, God,
he's got a whole, he posted his day. It's like every
really?
Hour is accounted for.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What time does he go to bed at night?
Like 9? Oh, 7. He goes at 7.
7?
When he released his schedule, everybody was like, I'm a loser.
That's really?
I don't do anything. I'm worthless.
And he's got a bunch of kids, right?
Yeah, like 4 or 5.
Oh, my God.
Jeez.
Well, he's one of those guys. Yeah. You could see it. He's one of those guys that knows he got lucky. He knows he got
yeah.
lucky.
Right. Hanging
which
on.
Which applies yeah. to us, too. And you go, I'm not going to screw this up. This
right.
is too sweet.
Yeah.
yeah.
Get your system, Tom.
To me, what you need
mm-hmm.
Is a sealed space.
Right.
To go home and do this, that to me is a nightmare. That's
yeah.
the opposite. You got to have a place that you go from here.
Yeah.
That's not home.
Right.
Not work. And it's yours. And you're sealed up inside there.
Right. My home office is great when the kids are at school. Like I rolled home yesterday and there was 5 17-year-old girls running through the house, playing music, and,
yeah.
you know.
I mean, I assume they're paying you for this.
Yes.
Okay, take that money.
Right.
And get yourself a nice office somewhere near here.
That's yeah. smart.
And you drive your car there.
Yeah.
Right.
And when you walk into that cube, your brain is going to know, I know what we're doing here.
Right.
That's good. And then it will do it.
See?
There you go.
Solutions.
Yeah.
yeah.
You
who at the comedy store? Who at the comedy store gives you that advice?
No,
yeah.
no idea.
You treat your brain like a schnauzer. And you got your little bag of treats and tricks, and you're gonna learn to walk on hind legs. And he will.
Yeah.
He will. He wants those treats. And you want those bits.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
no,
you'll, so here's your little treat bag.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Well, thank you so much. This was great. Yeah. If you want to keep the thermos, you can.
Thank you.
Your parting gift.
It should be your parting gift from What a Joke. Yeah, I don't know what you throw here. Yeah, it's not perfect. It's clanky, too, which isn't great for radio. Well, thank you so much, Sherry.
Yeah,
this was an amazing thing. This is the beginning of our show, and we couldn't. It's all downhill from
How
here.
How do we top this?
You will.
You just heard the last episode of What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. Thank you all. Enjoy your day.
Thank you.